Om Shuklam Bharadaram Vishnam Shashi Varnam Chaturbhujam Prasanna Vadhanam Dhyayet Sarva Vigno Pashantahe. Hari Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Team Param Vedanta extends a warm welcome to one and all for today's 14th session of Bhagavad Gita verse by verse. One of the most important questions our teachings of Bhagavad Gita is to concentrate on our goal, do our work and not focus on the end result. In life, all of us have our own goals in mind. May it be the coveted promotion or buying the dream house or marrying a person of your dreams. Instead of preparing for the role by acquiring necessary skills and strengths, if we while away our time in dreaming about the perks, benefits, power, happiness, etc., the goal will become difficult and at times out of reach. In this Karma Yoga chapter, Lord Krishna explains the importance of doing our duty rather than focusing on the end result. When we focus on the reward, we become prone to worries. In case the result is not as desired or failed, it may lead to anger and ultimately depression. Hence, the timeless teaching of Bhagavad Gita, where we are told to do our duty as our swadharma with Krishnarpana Bhava and accept the result as the Lord's prasada. Please listen intently to the Lord's teachings in verses 11 to 18 of Karma Yoga chapter 3, which will be explained by our Param Vedanta teachers led by Dr. Timmappa Hegdesa. Madhusudan ji will chant Bhagavad Gita verses 11 to 18 at the end. I request all to stay and join in the chanting or even attempt. This will surely benefit us. Chetana ji will give us a recap of the previous sessions verses 5 to 10 of the chapter on Karma Yoga. Chetana ji, please.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. The third chapter is titled Karma Yoga. Earlier, Krishna had summarized Karma Yoga in the 47th and the 48th verse of the second chapter. What is Karma Yoga? Karma Yoga is the right action and right attitude. And what is right action? Actions that benefit not only me, but also others. What is right attitude? Ishvara Arpana Bhava and Prasada Bhakti. Now, because of Arjuna's filtered listening, he does not grasp Krishna's teaching very clearly. So the third chapter begins with Arjuna's question, which sadhana is important, Karma Yoga or Jnana Yoga? For this, a traditional metaphor can be used. To cook rice, we need four things, fire, rice, water, and pot. Can you cook rice if one of these are missing? No, all are important, as without one of them, you cannot cook the rice. In the same way, both Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga are important. Therefore, Sri Krishna says there is no choice with regard to these two sadhanas, but you have a choice with regard to the lifestyle, grahastha or sannyasa ashrama. So Jnana Yoga is the only means of liberation, and for that, I need the necessary qualification, which I get through Karma Yoga. So from the fourth verse onwards in the third chapter, Krishna gives reasons why Karma Yoga is important. In the fourth verse, he says, by giving up actions and taking to sannyasa does not guarantee moksha. Knowledge alone gives moksha. In last week's class, we saw the second reason given in the fifth verse, where Krishna says that it is impossible to give up all the actions, a karma krit, even for a moment, apikshanam. Why? Because every person is forced to do one action or the other by the three gunas of prakriti or maya. Then in the sixth verse, Krishna addresses the one who has become a sannyasi for all the wrong reasons. He says, if the mind is not ready for sannyasa, then externally there is detachment, but mentally the person may be dwelling upon the worldly things he has given up. And such a person he calls a mithyachara, a hypocrite, and a vimudatma, a deluded person. Vedanta talks about growing out of worldly desires, not suppressing them. Thus, the third reason Krishna tells Arjuna is, do not think of sannyasa, instead think of an active life. Now, what kind of an active life is given in the seventh verse? Leading a life of karma yoga is the answer. Convert all our worldly activities into a spiritual practice, a sadhana. Here, Krishna talks about the one who is not a mithyachara. How does he conduct himself? He says this person engages in karma yoga, but is unattached, asaktaha. And such a person excels, sa vishishyate. The key word here in this verse is asaktaha, which means detachment. What does it mean to work with detachment? Detachment does not mean you don't care about the result. It means your happiness or contentment is not reliant on the situation, person, or object. You do your best, but your happiness is not dependent on the outcome. Therefore, a karma yogi is engaged in action with detachment. Then from the verse 8 to 20, Krishna elaborately discusses the topic of karma yoga. And in the 8th verse, Krishna says, akarmanaha karma jayahe. Action is always superior to inaction because, as we saw in the previous shloka, an idle mind is a devil's workshop. He says, your sharira yatra, the journey of your life, will be impossible if you do not do karma. As action is required for even our basic needs like food, clothing, and shelter. At least to maintain your health and livelihood, you will have to work. And the type of action you have to do is niyatam karma kuru. You do those actions which are prescribed in the scriptures as compulsory actions, like pancha maha yajnas. So here Krishna asks us to do karma yoga as an Ishvara agnya or an Ishvara vidhi. It is a commandment for an immature student. Whereas in the 9th verse, he's addressing the mature students and says, convert karma yoga into Ishvara yajna, an offering to God. Yajnartham karma. It is converting our very life into a puja and considering the whole world as God. Therefore, to offer your work to the Lord, you need not go to the temple. Convert every action into worship. But what happens if you don't convert your action into worship? He says, karma bandhanaha. Then every action will become a bondage for you. Therefore, do your actions properly. Karma samachara. And how? Mukta sangaha, freed from attachment. Then in the last verse 10, having created the human beings, the creator Prajapati says, may you prosper through this yajna and your desires fulfilled by the ishta kamadhu or kamadhenu. Your kamadhenu can be taken as a symbolic expression of the human intellect. Therefore, in conclusion, avoiding karma or inaction does not guarantee peace of mind or moksha. Inaction is impossible because of our gunas. All the suppressed desires come up when a person has nothing to do. An idle mind is a devil's workshop. So in a sense, without karma yoga, jnana yoga is impossible. And without jnana yoga, karma yoga is incomplete. Therefore, follow karma yoga, acquire jnana yogyata, get jnanam and be free. Thank you. Hari Om.
Thank you, Chetana, for a nice summary of the previous class. Sadashiva samarambham Shankaracharya madhyamam Asmadacharya pariyantam Vande Guru Paramparam. Om. Karma Yoga is a sadhana to get Jnana Yogyata. Once Jnanam is obtained, Karma Yoga becomes irrelevant. It does not mean that the person does not do anything, but now it does not become a sadhana. Now it becomes, as we will see in subsequent classes, if you become a role model for others, and this is called Loka Sangraha. It is like a pole vaulter making use of a pole to cross a certain height. This is an expression for us to know because karma yoga is a sadhana. A sadhaka, all of us, the seekers, make use of a spiritual exercise, the sadhana, to achieve our goal, which is actually jnana yogyata. Jnana yogyata is our goal or the sadhyam, and become a siddha, become accomplished in whatever we need to attain. Once we have crossed the bar, it is important that we need to let go of the pole. Karma yoga no longer becomes a sadhana. It is like a person using the coaching classes for IAS or for IIT. And once a person has accomplished it, he no longer needs to go back to all these classes. Why am I insisting on all this? Those of you who have been reading Adi Shankara's Bhashyams on Karma Yoga, you will see again and again Adi Shankara refers to what is called Jnana Karma Samuchaya Vada. What is Jnana Karma Samuchaya Vada? This is a school which accepts that even after Jnanam, karma or ritualistic action can be combined. There were great philosophers called Bodhayana and subsequently Bhaskara who have written great commentaries on the Brahma Sutras, who were contemporaries of Adi Shankara. And because they were very influential people, Adi Shankara had to emphasize that it is not possible to combine these two things because after all, karma yoga is a sadhana to get to jnana yogyata. And once a person attains to jnana yogyata, continuing to do all these ritualistic karmas does not make sense to the understanding of Adi Shankara, who is very clearly from the school of Advaita Vedanta, which is also what we understand is the binary format. A jnani does not see anything outside to be apart from himself. And therefore, it is impossible for him to do any karma which involves a sense of duality. Such a person has what is called sarva karma parityagya. He gives up all forms of karma to obtain a certain goal. He may do a lot of actions, but this is coming out of fulfillment, but not for fulfillment. And therefore, jnana karma samuchaya is not possible. And that is what Adi Shankara repeatedly brings out in his Bhashyams. In today's classes from verses 11 to 18, we see the sum and the essence of karma yoga. The first two verses for today will be explained by Dr. Raksha. Dr. Raksha, please.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Verse 10 discussed karma yoga as a yajna and as kamaduk, stressing the importance of spiritual growth along with material growth to lead a balanced life. This verse, verse 11, is highlighting the aspect of dharma while performing actions. Devan bhavayata nena te deva bhavayantu vaha parasparam bhavayantaha shreyav paramavapsyata. Devan bhavayata, may you nourish the gods. Anena, by this yajna, te devaha bhavayantu vaha, may the gods nourish us. Bhavayantav parasparam, nourishing each other, param shreyam avapsyata, you will attain supreme good. Lord Krishna continues with the same concept of yajna in this verse, karma yoga performed with reverence. Anena, here is the sacrifice in the form of performance of swadharma or one's own duty. Can I have the next slide, sir? According to the Shastras, devatas are the presiding deities over the natural forces, like Indra being the lord of rain and thunder, Varuna the lord of oceans, and so on. When we propitiate the gods who are in the form of nature, they in turn give us plenty of timely rain, crops, food grains, vegetation, etc. Nature and we live in harmony. There is an ecological balance. This is parasparam bhavayantaha. We should cooperate with nature and not attempt to conquer. Sattvic karma or selfless action is one in which I contribute to the world more and I take less from the world. As depicted in the next slide, when we water the roots of the plants, it reaches flowers, fruits, leaves, and all the parts of the plants. When karma yoga is done as a yajna, within the boundaries of dharma, it takes us towards parama purushartha, which is param shreyaha. Can I have the next slide? Lord Krishna describes the tamasic person in verse 12. Ishtan bhogan hi vo deva dasyante yajna bhavitaha tair dattan pradayebhyah yobunte stena evasaha. Devaha yajna bhavitaha, the gods who are nourished by yajna, dasyante hi vaha, will indeed give you ishtan bhogan, all the desired pleasures. Yaha bhungte, he who enjoys, taihi dattan, the gifts bestowed by them, apradayebhyaha, without offering to them, stena eva saha, he is undoubtedly a thief. As depicted in the next slide, Lord Krishna says, when you lead a life of worship, yajna bhavitaha devaha ishtan bhogan dasyante, God will bless you with everything you want. If you are interested in dharma, artha and kama, karma yoga will bless you with it. But if you are more interested in moksha, karma yoga will bless you with that. So karma yoga gives both material and spiritual benefits. Ashirvajanam kale varshatu parjanyaha prithivi sasya shalini deshoyam kshobha rahitaha is an example of receiving the blessings of nature in abundance. The next slide shows, with the blessings thus received, taihi dattan bhungtva, we should have an attitude of gratitude. Apradaya is not reciprocating, not offering. Having received, if one does not have the thought of repaying or giving back, Lord Krishna uses a harsh word. He says, stena eva saha, such a person is verily a thief. Shastras say, kritagne nasti nishkritihi, for an ungrateful person, there is no prayaschittam. Every moment of our life must be one of gratitude and reverence. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Raksha, for a nice explanation of verses number 11 and 12. From my understanding, I have highlighted the word parasparam bhavayantaha. That means it is a mutual relationship between us and the gods. And whenever we make karma as an offering to the Lord, it becomes Ishvara Arpana Bhava. So what happens is, whenever we receive anything from nature, whenever we receive anything, maybe food, maybe health, let us receive it with a sense of gratefulness. Is it that all the gods, the presiding deities, are they reliant on our small offering that we make? More importantly, is the bhava, the attitude with which we make. When we come with the attitude of gratefulness, it is like the sun that is always shining. When we have this attitude, it is like we have put up our solar panels and are able to download the blessings. And that is how, if every action of ours becomes Ishvara Arpana, this becomes Paraspara Bhavayantaha. And if you do not do that, Sri Krishna gives a very strong word, we are like a thief. We are only consuming and we are not having the attitude of gratefulness. What do you mean by bringing in this gratefulness attitude? It means that whatever we receive before we eat our food, if we make it as an offering to God, whatever we eat now becomes a prasada. The second is, Now I am so grateful to all that I received. I will lead my life in a very dharmic manner. And a dharmic manner, as far as karma yoga, is focus on not what you would like to do, but as whatever role in my life, whatever I have to do. When does it become an agnya or a sacrifice? When the focus is more on what I am supposed to do and if I'm doing the right thing. If I have this attitude, it is called Ishwara Arpana Buddhi, and this is what is called Karma Yoga. We have verse 13, which is another very important verse. Kartik, please.
Namaskara. We are at that stage of Bhagavad Gita where Krishna explains Karma Yoga in detail to Arjuna and to us, of course. Under the different angles of Karma Yoga or the reasons for us to pursue Karma Yoga, we saw two out of four in the previous shlokas. In eight, we saw agnya as a commandment or a decree or a directive, niyatam of the master of the universe. This is the first level. We saw that in the first level, we follow karma yoga more out of fear. Then it is the least mature of the sadhakas. The attitude of such a sadhaka will be, the whole universe runs on the Lord's command. Bhishasmad Vatapati, all the elements run on his command. He has created us and he has also created a set of rules and we have to follow. This is the attitude. Secondly, a more mature and a more recommended approach is the yajna. In slokas, 9, 12, and even in the current sloka, we look at yajna as, yajna as worship, sharing and cooperation, and most importantly, gratitude. We do know, gratitude is an emotion, as they say, which has the least mileage. So from a karmi to a karma yogi, this gratitude becomes, kind of a very important emotion. It's to be consciously grateful of everything. So that is yajna. Then at the second level, the sadhakas are more mature and karma yoga is practiced not out of fear, but as gratitude, as worship, and as acknowledgement of everything that a person has received. Now we see more mature sadhakas who practice karma yoga for purification of the mind. That is chitta shodhakam, as we will see in the next slide. Now we see how sadhakas whose only goal is moksha. It is as opposed to the dharma, artha, kama goals of the previous two levels. Then the sadhaka's clearly defined objective is moksha. He realizes that the only means to attain moksha is atmajnana. Now, atmajnana is impossible without a purified mind. And what is a purified mind? It has a mind with no impurities, as we see. The desire, anger, pride, delusion, greed, and jealousy. For this, one must give up selfishness. So, the next slide says, this is the sloka. Yajnashishtha shina santaha muchyante sarva khilbishaihi bhunjate te tvagam papa ye pachantyatma karanat. So the thing is, those who eat, having first offered food to the Lord, are released from impurities, whereas those sinful people who cook only for themselves eat papa. Now, the previous slokas we saw, who does not perform without any offering or without any yajna, not as a yajna, but as an act, selfish act, he becomes a thief. Now we are talking about an equally strong message that Krishna says, that we eat if we do not offer it to people, and if you do not do anything as an offering and do it only for yourselves, you are committing more sin. So you have to acknowledge the forces at work, and then only then it becomes a karma yoga. The next slide, doctor. So this is the first line. Yajnashishta ashinaha santaha sarva kilbishai muchyanti. The word yajna actually comes from the root yaj, which means worship. And there are so many meanings of yajna, but here we are focusing only on the worship part of it. Yajna here also means offering, worshipful offering. So the attitude to practice before and while eating is be conscious that it is a spiritual and worshipful activity. Invoke and thank the devatas at work. Offer it to the Lord. And while eating, treat the food as yajna shishtam. Maintain the bhavana of prasada. So, the devatas are actually the forces at work that have resulted in us having this food. And we offer chitrahuti before we eat. So the chitrahuti we do. All this is an offering. It is basically, we do take a remnants of what is given up. So let's go, if I'm just going into the word meaning, yajna is offering, shishta is remnants, ashinaha is people who eat, santaha is noble or righteous persons. So the meaning becomes those noble people who first having offered to the Lord, if we offer to the Lord, then automatically the impurities are released or we are free from impurities. So conversely, now if you do not do as suggested, what happens? So here is a condemnation. Krishna condemns, if not then, you know, that is the logic. If the cooking is done with the only intent of tending to our own hunger, automatically the act of cooking and consequently eating lends itself to papa. So yetu is whereas those who atmakarana is for the sake of themselves, pachanti is cook, they are sinners and they eat sin. So now we see the eating and cooking represents all actions which produce favorable and unfavorable results. We see this throughout Bhagavad Gita and most of the scriptures. Eating is it is representative of all karmas. Now Vedanta says that anything that obstructs self-knowledge is papa. Even if I have a lot of riches and sense pleasures, and because of those sense pleasures, I am lost in the world and I do not try to grow spiritually, the very same sense pleasures are papa. Even money is considered a papa if I am going to be lost in them and I am not going to pursue spirituality at one time or the other. On the other hand, even poverty is considered punya if poverty leads us to self-inquiry. If because of poverty, a person is able to spend time in spirituality, then poverty actually becomes wealth. Therefore, we define punya as whatever promotes spiritual growth, and we define papa as whatever obstructs spiritual growth. This is called kilbisham in the shloka. And all the papams go away if we perform all actions as yajna to purify our mind and as a means to attain moksha. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Karthik, for a nice explanation of this verse. As you will see, muhyanti sarva kilbishaha. That means normally whenever we do any action, karma can be binding. It can create punya, it can create papa. And therefore, we need to see in karma how we can convert karma into a yoga so that we do not incur any karmas, any punya or papa. There is another word called agaha, agam. This means sin. Such a person will not incur sin if you do it as a yajna. Now, we have heard the word anaga. Anaga is one who is incapable of sin, one who is beyond sin. Now, how to convert karma into a yoga? And this verse talks about being so grateful that I'm able to accept whatever I get as a prasada. If I do not have this attitude of gratefulness, there will be a spiritual fall, because there is a tendency for many people who have accomplished many things to see that they have accomplished it on their own. Let us always remember that we stand on the shoulders of so many people who have come before, and let us acknowledge that we, whatever success that we have achieved is because of our parents, teachers, and friends. And therefore, we should have a sense of gratefulness even for this gift of health, a gift of a normal mind. If I'm able to be grateful all the time, then I have a certain prasada bhava. I will be able to accept everything gratefully. There is a beautiful poem which goes like this. I asked for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I had asked for, but everything I had hoped for. And despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I am among all men most richly blessed. You will see, therefore, it is this bhava of prasada bhava, to be able to accept, will become a chitta shodakam. It will purify your mind, and mukti sadakam, it paves the way to mukti. The next two verses, verses 14 and 15, will be by Dr. Anupama. Over to you, Dr. Anupama.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, verses 14 and 15. Annat bhavanti bhutani parjanya anna sambhavah, yajnat bhavanti parjanyah, yajna karma sambhavah, karma samudbhavam viddhi, Brahma Akshara Samudbhavan, Tasmat Sarvagatam Brahma, Nityam Yagne Pratishtitam. Here we see Karma Yoga as Pancha Mahayajna. What is meant by Yajna? Yajna literally means action or karma. In this context, it means the Punya Phalam of karma. God created this universe with an attitude of Yajna. Universe means uni, one unit. By dedicating our actions, their results, and ourselves to the Lord, we give ourselves to the totality and get the totality. Here, we see a drop of water that's struggling to hold on to its individuality. But when it drops into the lake, it just becomes the lake. This verse describes the cosmic cycle. The core of the cosmic cycle is yajna. The attitude of yajna helps us tune in with this cosmic cycle. As responsible beings, we have to contribute more than we can consume. When consumption exceeds contribution, the cyclic harmony is disrupted, as in the indiscriminate use of plastics or insensible deforestation and urbanization. In these verses, Lord Krishna tells us how our contribution in the form of Pancha Mahayajnas maintains the cosmic harmony. Annat bhavanti bhutani. Anna here means food. Food sustains all living beings. It nurtures our physical, emotional, and spiritual needs. Our diet is not just what we eat, but what we watch, read, what we listen to, and the people we associate with. From where does this food come? Parjanyat anna sambhavah. Parjanya means rain. Rain facilitates the growth of food grains. In a broader perspective, rain represents the result of collective effort or teamwork, which creates a conducive atmosphere for growth. For example, it rains spirituality in India, it rains entertainment in Hollywood, it rains devotion at satsangas. What causes the rains? Yajnat bhavati parjanya. Yajna causes rain. Yajna means the adrishta punya phalam resulting from collective punya karmas. Yajna is the link between Pancha Mahayajna and universal harmony. We believe that oblations offered to Agni Devata reach Surya Devata in a subtle form. Surya evaporates the oceanic waters and forms clouds. Vayu Devata transports these clouds in appropriate places and pours out the rain. What is the cause of yajna? Yajna karma samudbhava. Karma, if Vaidika, in the form of Pancha Mahayajnas, or Laukika, in the form of a reverential contribution to nature and fellow human beings, generates an adrishta punya phalam or yajna. Therefore, yajna is born out of karma. How do we know about Pancha Mahayajnas? Karma brahmodbhavam vidhi. Brahma here means Vedas. We get the knowledge of these karmas from Veda. But Vedas are apaurusheya pramanas. From where do these Vedas originate? Brahma akshara samudbhavam. Akshara here means Ishvara. Brahma means Veda. Samudbhava bhava means gets manifested. Vedas are described as the very breath of the Lord. The Lord is the source of the Vedas. Wherever karma yoga is operational, Veda and Ishvara are latently present in the form of an enlightened lifestyle. Tasmat sarvagatam brahma. The Vedas, called Brahma here, give us the knowledge of the entire creation, Ishvara, Jiva, and Jagat. When light illumines objects, it pervades these objects. Similarly, the wisdom of the Vedas illumines the entire universe and pervades it. Therefore, it is sarvagatam. Also, Veda Pramana is Shabda Pramana. Shabda, as we know, has the property of Akasha and is all pervading. Nityam means always. Yajna means in the place where yajnas are performed, and pratishtitam means the Veda dwells. Although wisdom of the Vedas is all pervading, being the source of Panchamaha Yajnas, the Vedic presence is manifest in places where these yajnas are performed. Just as a temple is not a place of location, but of realization of the Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anupama, for a nice presentation of these two verses, which talk of a certain cyclical order that comes on whenever karma yoga is practiced. To recap again, all beings, all the bhutanis, exist because of annam or food. Where does food come? Food is possible because of rain. How is rain possible? Because of yajna. And what does yajna mean? As nicely explained, it is the collective punya. Because of certain punya, it rains. How do we know yajna? How do we know what is to be done right? And that comes from karma. That karma is given to us from Brahma. What is Brahma here? Brahma here means the Vedas. The Vedas come from Aksharam. Aksharam means the Lord. Ultimately, what are we trying to say? Everything comes to us from the Lord. One needs to be very sensitive. Whatever I have, whatever I will receive is a prasada from the Lord. And if a person has this attitude, then you will have a yajna attitude to whatever we do. We have a beautiful verse in the 7th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, which says, Mattaha parataram nanyat kinchid asti dananjaya, my sarvam idam protam sutre manigana eva. A student is always sensitive to the presence of the Lord everywhere, and therefore, whatever I do it as an offering to the Lord, and whatever I get in return, I receive it as a prasada. Verse 16 will be explained to us by Pallavi. Over to you, Pallavi.
Hari Om. Evam pravartitam chakram nanu vartayati hayaha agharyundriya mano mogham partha sajivati. In this shloka, Lord Krishna says, in this world, she who does not follow the cycle, the law of compensation, which is initiated by the Lord in a certain manner, is a sinful and sensual person. She lives in vain, O Arjuna. The human kinds are of three reciprocity types: takers, matchers, and givers. Karma yogi are the givers. When people accept their responsibility to live as an integral part of the universal system, material prosperity abounds and spiritual growth is engendered. She believes and practices this very equation in every action to lead a successful life. A karma yogi is a person practicing spirituality. For example, individuals such as Buddha, Nelson Mandela, Mother Teresa, a few of them. Whereas Karmi executes activities only for her personal gains. She believes and practices this very equation in every action. the delusional equation of a karmi is as follows. Karmi equals hoarding or discord in the mechanism of the cosmic cycle, which is giving less and taking more. It's almost a wasted life, and deficiency of spirituality is there. For example, people like Hitler, Ravana, Kaikeyi are some of them. So karmi is an ignorant person. Therefore, Krishna strongly criticized karmi in this shloka. He says, evam pravartitam chakram. The cosmic cycle is an ordered series of events, of actions, performed to contribute towards the harmony or balance of this cycle. We can thus either contribute to the harmony of the cycle or bring about discord in the smooth running of this cosmic mechanism. Yaha na anuvartayati. When human beings begin to violate the universal system and rejects its responsibility as an integral part of the cosmic system, such people bring about discord in the smooth running of this cosmic mechanism. Here Krishna says such a person is aghayu. Her life is made up of papam or sinful activities. Indriya Ramaha. She is a sensualist human who only spends her entire life for sensory pleasures. She is an immature and ignorant person. Materialistic world is superior to her. Mogham saha jivati. He Partha, such a person lives in vain. She is neither useful while alive, because being a sensualist who breaks the cosmic cycle will not accomplish anything greater, nor when she is dead. A human being with only animal instincts of eating, drinking, procreation, and a lengthy lifespan cannot be considered as a super achievement. Her life is an utter waste and a burden for the society. Life is meaningful only when it's shared with the society. While in the process, a person accomplishes dharma and ultimately moksha. According to Krishna, for human beings, the real accomplishment is in the field of karma, yoga, and moksha, or else everything is in vain. Hari Om. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Pallavi. In this verse, we have seen how if you are a karma yogi, you will maintain dharma. You will maintain this cycle. And if you do not do that, you become a sinner. How do we maintain this cycle? It is that I shift from being a consumer to being a contributor. Unless I'm able to contribute, if I'm only being a consumer, then it will become a sin. The cycle is not maintained. So far, what have we studied? Karma yoga can be initially as an agnya for an immature person. To a more mature person, it is a yajna. To an even more mature person who has the higher vision of getting moksha, karma yoga can be chitta shodhaka. It can purify my instrument, that is my mind, and make it eligible for jnanam. And finally, in the whole process, I follow the certain dharma and maintain a certain order in the universe. There is a slight shift now in verse 17, which will be explained to us by Venkatesh Prasad. Over to you, Venkatesh.
Thank you, sir. Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. In the shloka 3.14, we saw how the wheel of action works. The entire cycle hinges on the concept of giving. Just to take one example given by Swami Paramarthananda, human being gets oxygen from atmosphere and exhales carbon dioxide, which is used by plants for photosynthesis, and they in turn release oxygen into the atmosphere for use of human beings. As we saw in Shloka 3.16, Krishna says that anyone who doesn't help maintain this cycle and consumes more than his contribution to society, he is a thief, sinner, and his life is a waste. These shlokas eulogize karma yoga. Next slide, sir. Now, Krishna turns to jnana yoga in shloka 3.17, which reads thus. Yastvatmaratirevasyat amrut atruptascha manavaha. Atma truptascha manavaha, Atman eva cha santushtah tasya karyam avidyate. Meaning, however, suppose there is a man who loves the self alone, who is happy with the self alone, and who is contented with the self alone, there is nothing to be accomplished for him. Getting confused? In previous shlokas, it is said karma is a must, but here it is said that there is no karma for a jnani. Swami Paramarthananda says that karma yoga cannot give liberation or self-knowledge. Hence, karma yoga cannot be an end in itself. But at the same time, karma yoga is not useless also. It is extremely important for a beginner to gain purity of mind. Only purified mind can go to the next higher sadhana of jnana yoga. Hence, karma yoga to attain purity of mind and jnana yoga to attain moksha with that purified mind. We go to the next slide and see the self-inquiry suggested by Shankara after serving society and achieve chitta shuddhi. Kastvam koham kutayatah kame janani kome tatah iti paribhavaya sarvam saram vishvam tyatva svapna vicharam. Let us see next slide and see what Swami Paramarthananda says. Without jnana yoga, karma yoga is incomplete. Without karma yoga, jnana yoga is impossible. So, lead an active life of pravritti marga in brahmacharya and grihastha ashrama, which is karma yoga, and move on to the nivritti marga in vanaprastha and sannyasa ashrama, which is jnana yoga. Pravritti stage is one of involvement, and nivritti stage is of seclusion or withdrawal. As we move on to the next slide, let us see Swami Chinmayananda, who explains this transition beautifully. Through selfless work, karma yoga, an individual gains an increasing amount of inner poise, and when such a single-pointed mind is brought to function at the meditation seat, the meditator gains the experience of transcending his limited ego. To such a perfected one, work is not a training to purify himself, but it is the fulfillment of his own God-realization. He continues, satisfaction and contentment are two wheels of life chariot. In order to gain better satisfaction and to reach nearer to the point of contentment, we are goaded to act in the external world. But a man who has transcended his limited identification with his matter envelopments, he comes to feel so satisfied with his selfhood, he experiences a complete sense of contentment in the very divine nature, and that provides eternal satisfaction to him. Atma truptascha manavaha. Not just that, atman eva cha santushtah. Where satisfaction and contentment have arrived, there in that bosom, desires cannot arise at all. Because this is the state of infinity he has discovered, and that is the ultimate, since there is no infiniter and infinitest. His self-sufficiency is total. He does not depend on any external factors for happiness. I am is not one of the sources of happiness, but the only source of happiness. Thereafter, whatever he does is not done for fulfillment. Whatever he does is out of fulfillment. Thereafter, he is free to act or not to act, to serve or not to serve, and lives a godman upon the earth. Tasya karyam na vidyate. Hari Om. Thank you.
Thank you, Venkatesh Prasad, for a very nice explanation of an important verse. Here, all the words are important, but I will focus on the word tu. I will explain the word soon. Yastu atma ratireva syat, atma triptasya manavaha, atma neva cha santushta, tasya karyam na vidyate. The word tu here means but. Whenever somebody is in a conversation and suddenly you say but means you're trying to change the topic. What is the change of topic? Until now we were seeing karma yoga. Now there is a shift into a jnana yoga. Krishna is essentially trying to say karma yoga is a sadhana that helps us to lead to jnana yoga. And what is the ultimate in jnana yoga? Atma rati means a one who is reveling in oneself. Atma truptasya, one who is purna and one who is content. Atman evascha santushtaha. There is a very important Vedantic phrase called avidya kama karma. Avidya means I do not know my true nature. I think I'm a limited person. And because I am limited, a thought enters into my mind that if I'm able to accomplish something, then I will attain to purnatvam. And that thought is the desire or the driving force that makes me, forces me into action. So avidya is the grandfather. Father of karma is kama, and the action is karma. Now, what happens to a person who has jnana? Scriptures say our whole purpose is to discover that we are not this ordinary body-mind complex. That is why we are into this whole process of jnana yoga. And through karma yoga sadhana, when the mind is purified and when we attend into the Gita and Upanishad classes, the guru is able to introduce us to somebody whom we probably never knew before, the real self or the Atma. Once a person discovers your real nature, then a person now discovers that I am so full by myself. If others are there, if any other objects, situations or persons are there, I revel, I am happy, but then if nobody is there, I am complete by myself. Such a person may work, may not work, but he is not driven to work. Tasya karyam na vidyate. He has no binding desires, and therefore, because there is no binding desires, he is not compelled to work. Let me share a story of a certain Sufi saint that I have shared earlier before, who was traveling with a group of his friends across a desert, reaches a particular oasis. They're all hungry, looking for food. And it is so happens a certain rich person is hosting a banquet. And when you're hungry, you approach wherever food is available. You have no sense of, and they entered the place. The rich man was inviting all the guests. And suddenly when he saw the Sufi saint along with a group of followers, he said, "But who are you? I do not know who you are." And suddenly it occurred to him, "But I know myself." And then he reflected. He said, "How unfortunate it would be if the whole world knew me, but I did not know myself." Which means more important than the whole world knowing me is, do I know myself? Now, this is the whole purpose of Atma Vidya or Brahma Vidya. We spend so much efforts that others get to know us. For the sake of publicity, we are ready. For the sake of good publicity, we are ready to do anything. But on the other hand, our whole spiritual vision is get to know yourself. Once you know yourself, Atman, Atmaneva Santushta, Atmaneva Tripti, and you are able to reveal yourself, Atma Ratireva Syat. We go to the other very similar verse, which goes like this. The verse 18 is like this. Naiva tasya krite nartho, na krite na kaschana, na chasya sarva bhuteshu, kaschid artavya ashraya. All right. Here, the key word here is asaktaha. Asaktaha means when there is no attachment, when a person has realized his true nature, he is so complete in himself, there is no attachment to any objects or persons or situations. Tasya, for such a person, na eva artaha, there is no goal to be accomplished. Kritena, through actions. Na kaschana, nor nothing to be accomplished eva akritena, through inaction. That means there is nothing to be accomplished by non-action or through action. Asya, for such an enlightened person, kaschid, there is absolutely nothing. Artavya apshraya, that means such a person is not dependent on any objects or sarva bhuteshu, is not dependent on any persons or any objects whatsoever. What a wonderful state to be when you are purnam by yourself. Imagine a state when your to-do list is complete. You have done everything that there is needs to be done. There is no more a bucket list left unfulfilled. Everything you have accomplished, you can tell yourself, there is nothing to do. There is nowhere to go. Why? You are already that which you can possibly be. Let me share a little about Sri Vidyaranya, who was also, among other accomplishments, the Jagat Guru of Sringeri Sharada Pita. And he has written in the 7th chapter of Panchadashi an elaborate explanation of one verse of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, and the verse goes like this: Atmanam ched vijaniyat ayam asmiti purushah kim bichan kasya kamaya shariram anusandada yati. Now this verse from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, one atman eva atmanam ched vijaniyat, one person, the person who clearly knows whose true nature, ayam asmiti purushah, one who has understood himself, kimichan, what desire arises in his mind, and what does he have to struggle with this body, which means he has nothing to achieve. And yet such people who have nothing to achieve are so productive, who has written 298 verses helping us to work on our spiritual path. And what does he say? That if you know yourself, there is nothing to be attained, there is nothing to be accomplished in this world, and such a person still work, but not for fulfillment, but out of fulfillment. And all these verses will come in the next class of the Bhagavad Gita, in the next class that we have seen. So continuing here, if the person attains to Brahma Vidya, what happens? There is no struggle with the body. Why? There is no ahankara. When the desirer is not there, there is no desire, there is no object of desire, and therefore there is no need to do anything. There is no struggle to prove anything to anybody. So we look at the same verse, naiva tasya kritenartho na akritena kaschana. That means through action or inaction, there is nothing to be done, because such a person is not dependent on any goal to be accomplished, or he's not dependent on any person. So in the next class, which will be on the 25th of June, we will be studying verses on the third chapter from verses 19 to 26. It is continuation of the same theme, how a jnani like Janaka and others, who have attained to everything and yet are so busy. Shri Krishna gives himself as an example. And he says, yad yad acharati shreshta. You know how you need to be a role model for all the others. With this, we conclude today's class. We will conclude by a chanting of these verses from 11 to 18 by Madhusudan. Over to you, Madhu.
Rubhyo namaha. Devan bhavayata nena te deva bhavayantu vaha parasparam bhavayantah shreyah paramavapsyatha ishtan bhogan hivo devah dasyante yajna bhavitah tairdattana pradayaibhyah yo bhunkte sthena yevasah yajna shishtashina santah muchyante sarva kilvishaihi bhunjate te twagham papah ye pachantyatma karanat annat bhavanti bhutani parjanyadanna sambhavah yajnat bhavati parjanyah yajna karma samudbhavah karma brahmodbhavam vidhi brahmakshara samudbhavam tasmat sarvagatam brahma nityam yajne pratishthitam evam pravartitam chakram nanuvartayati hayah अघायुरिन्द्रियारामः मोघं पार्थ स जीवति यस्त्वात्मरतिरेव स्यात् आत्मतृप्तश्च मानवः आत्मन्येव च सन्तुष्टः तस्य कार्यं न विद्यते नैव तस्य कृतानार्थः नाकृतेनेह कश्चन न चास्य सर्वभूतेषु कश्चिदर्थव्यपाश्रयः. हरि ओम्.
Our pranams and thanks to Dr. Timmappa Hegde sir and all the speakers for the wonderful explanations. As per the Shastras, every tree is compared to the hair on the body of the Lord, rivers to the blood vessels, Vedas to the breath of the Lord, and so on. If we continue to perform karma yoga as a yajna, as Panchamaha yajna, respecting the harmony of the cosmic cycle and to the benefit of the larger society, we are free of any papam or punyam, but by one who is Atma Santushta, who is self-content and happy with himself, doing with an attitude of not doing. If we enjoy nature's gifts without respecting it, then we are no more than a thief. Hearty thanks to Madhuji for the divine recitation of the verses of today's study. Our heartfelt thanks to all our participants for joining us in today's journey. I request all participants to study the notes on today's verses, which shall be shared on our Telegram group. Remember to join us again on 25th June at 6:45 p.m. for the next session, where we shall pursue our study of verses 19 to 26 of Karma Yoga. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Shri Krishna Pranamastu.